Welcome back to the MOOC course on corporate social responsibility. My name is Aradhana Malik and I'm helping you with this course. And we had started the discussion on CSR and sustainability and how sustainability fits in. And towards this end, we had initially talked about corporate citizenship and you know, how organizations can start helping the community by realizing that they are a part of the community, they are more empowered parts of the community that can help governments deliver what they either have chosen not to deliver or have been forced to withdraw or have not been able to deliver for various reasons. And with the within the Indian context, it's the last scenario, which is due to the complexity of you know, the geographical diversity, the cultural complexity, and various other reasons, the government has not been able to reach the areas where it has wanted to reach. So any and all help that it receives from corporate organizations is welcome, and that's true for any country that is, you know, I would not like to really call India a developing country at this point. We are way ahead of the game in many ways. So any country that is at the same stage as India's would be facing the same challenge. You know, they are trying, but they're still not able to reach the far-flung areas, or for various reasons they are not able to deliver what they are capable of and keen to deliver. And so that's where corporate citizenship comes in. Now, talking about sustainability, we had discussed a little bit about how a very, very important part of giving is also, you know, it's also maintaining it. So sustainability, what is sustainability? Now, before I get into this discussion, I would like to tell you that a large part of this presentation, actually all the slides are from a previous course that I taught last September, last year in 2016. It was an online MOOC course called Strategic Communication for Sustainable Development, and I have taken the liberty of using the same slides here because I want to tell you what sustainability is. So since I had developed those slides, I am choosing to, you know, I thought that instead of reinventing the wheel, I will share the same material with you. Of course, the discussions around those slides will be now focused towards whatever we have talked about in this course. So if you want more details on sustainability and communication for sustainability and communication for sustainable development, I suggest that you go through the videos for that course and you will get more inputs. So, you know, we are all working on in similar areas. So that's how we bring these things together. So what is sustainability? Now, the dictionary definition of sustainability is that the something that is ongoing, something that, you know, once set in motion just keeps going on, that is there, that is you know, it's not permanent, but as something is used, it is also replenished, so the cycle continues. So it is sustainable, it is in motion, but status quo is maintained by way of a parity between the output and the input into that dynamic system. So as far as sustainability is concerned, some perspectives here. Sustainability implies that society must use no more of a resource than can be generated. So going by what I just told you, you know, if we are using X amount of resources, we are cutting down 100 trees, you know, let's plant 100 trees. If we don't have the capacity to plant 100 trees, let's not cut down 100 trees. Let's just estimate, or let's just find out how many trees we can plant and cut down only those many, or maybe even lesser than that. The idea is that we must leave the world at least in the same condition, if not better, for the future generations. Okay. So now, sustainability refers to the preservation of capital, economic, social and environmental. Economic sustainability refers to maximizing the flow of income from a given stock of assets or capital while at least maintaining them. Environmental sustainability requires that conditions necessary for equal to the earth's resource base be met for each generation, and that each generation leave a lesser burden than they inherited, increasing the quantity and quality of ecological, human and man-made resources. So sustainability essentially refers to the preservation of state of a dynamic system. Okay, what is development? Development refers to betterment of human life. It is people-centric, and according to Professor Amartya Sen, development may be understood as a process that must lead to the expansion of people's freedoms. I'm not going to go into very much detail because this course is not about sustainable development. This course is about social responsibility. This course is about integrating or exploring all aspects of social responsibility. So I'm not going to get into very much detail on these slides, even though the same slides have been explained differently in that course. So if you want more inputs, then you can go through that. Development is about choices, and there is a video here, but I'm not going to show this to you. The link is there. If you have time, you can go through it yourself. So human development is the process that allows the expansion and amplification of people's capabilities and life choices. Some characteristics of human development: one, equitable access to resources, sustainable resources and institutions. The procurement and dissemination of knowledge aimed at rendering human beings responsible and participation. So let's just go through this. We need to have access to resources. We need to have institutions and resources that are sustainable, that are preserved in the same state. We need to engage in the procurement and dissemination of knowledge. That is, development, human development also refers to the procurement and dissemination of knowledge aimed at rendering human beings responsible. So we engage in or we acquire knowledge, and we share that knowledge with the sole aim of making human beings responsible. And human development also refers to participation in the activities that are going on. Okay. What is sustainable development? Continuing environmental and economic development towards the betterment of human life. The discussion started with environment, moved on to economic prosperity, and then its contribution to the betterment of human life. So what are we doing? We see problems in the environment. I belong to a state where we see the effects of global warming literally in our backyard, and I'll take the liberty of sharing a personal example with you. My hometown is on a hill slope, and the mountain that the mountain range that we are a part of used to be perpetually white, and that is why it earned the name Dholadhar, which means white razor edged mountain. But over the years we have seen that whiteness disappearing, which means the permanent snow, the permafrost, has melted. And there is nothing, the mountain is barren, it's just gray. So, we often joke about changing the name of the mountain to something more appropriate now, because the mountain is no longer white. It only turns white during the winter. And this is literally, we are witnessing the impact of global warming on something that, that we all knew to be true. When I was very, very young, we rarely had fans in our town, and there was no question of having air conditioners. And now we need air conditioners because the temperature at times touches 40 degrees Celsius in a place where temperature would not cross maybe 25 or 30 degrees at the most. So occasionally we would need fans. So these days, we for about 1 or 2 months we crave air conditioning because it becomes so hot. Only for a little while. I'm not trying to turn you away from the Himalayas, but then for a few hours every day it does get very, very hot. So people are installing ACs. So that's what I'm trying to tell you. This is something that we are talking about sustainable development. We are talking about maintaining status quo. Let us not, it's about continuing the development, or at a pace at which the environment is preserved, the social fabric is preserved, and we also preserve the tangible resources in terms of money. We make money out of whatever we are doing. So people, planet and profit, three pillars that sustainable development rests on. Okay, back to this. So it's, you know, development is meets the needs of the present life without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. We have used, we have what we have. We have been using whatever we have at our disposal. What about the future generations? What about people, you know, the younger generation that's going to come up, that's going to grow, and then, you know, by that time we'll be gone, and what are these children going to have when they grow up to be adults? Will they have the same number of forests and parks and greenery that we used to have? Maybe not. Will they breathe the same kind of fresh air? Maybe not, because we have seen a tremendous increase in the pollution levels all over the world. So, you know, if I get into that discussion, that will just eat into the time we have for this class. So you can see the direction that I'm going in. So development must meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Future generations are going to have their own needs, and we must not take away from the future generations that they are going, what they are going to be using to have lives at least as comfortable as ours, maybe possibly more. Okay, sustainable development refers to the societal process of exploration, learning and transformation. In order for development to continue indefinitely, it should balance the interests of different groups of people within the same generation and among generations, and do so simultaneously in three major interrelated areas: economic, social and environmental. So profit, people and planet. So three pillars that sustainable development rests on. Okay. So the three principles of sustainable development are, as discussed, environmental integrity, environmental integrity, social equity and economic prosperity. The environmental integrity principle ensures that human activities do not erode the earth's land, air and water resources, which means that we need to preserve the environment for our future generations. So if this principle, you know, if we follow this principle, we ensure that we don't eat into the resources for, or the earth's land, air and water resources for, you know, we don't eat into these resources too much. You know, we only consume whatever we can replenish. Now, there is a lot of discussion going on these days about the groundwater going down. I think I mentioned it earlier in this course also. In a few years time, we are not going to have fresh water. We are drilling so many tube wells. Some states have imposed a sanction on how many tube wells can be dug you know, especially in large cities. I believe there is a restriction now in New Delhi regarding this. So I'm not sure, but I've heard it. So that's possible. So, you know, we need to control this. Now, if you talk to the elders in your family, you will see that especially, you know, people who are in their 60s or 70s have seen you know, the excitement that was generated when natural gas, when gas cylinders started coming into people's homes, and then, you know, slowly we started eating into this resource. So there was a time when they were freely available. Of course, you had to book them, you still have to book them. But then, you know, so they have seen the transition from log chulas, you know, the burning areas, and the stoves, sorry, the log stoves, to gas cylinders, to, you know, the gas cylinders being more or less freely available, to a restriction on how much you can use. And now, of course, you know, we have gas pipelines in the home, and we are drilling for more and more natural gas. But then we know that, as the educated lot, we know that the supply is not going to last very long. So, you know, the petroleum products are also slowly, I mean, the quantity of petroleum products that we use is slowly going down, because all we are being advised to reduce the number of petroleum products we use, because these supplies not going to last very long. So, you know, I mean, things come and then we use them so much that nothing is left for the future generation. So things end. So when we talk about environmental integrity, we are talking about not really eating into the resources that we have. The number of forests has gone down. Water is going down. Rivers have dried up. You know, you must have seen this in your own areas. You know, what used to be rivers have now been reduced to rivulets. In fact, there's plantation there. Now the bridges are over pieces of land. You know, the bridges that were built over large water bodies. So why? Because the water has dried up. Then the social equity principles principle ensures that all members of society have equal access to resources and opportunities. So we must maintain the social fabric. In fact, we must enhance the connectedness within the social fabric. So then the economic prosperity principle promotes a reasonable quality of life through the productive capacity of organizations and individuals in society, which means that if we are an organization, then, you know, we must generate profit and we must utilize the inputs that people can give, the productive capacity of people and organizations in order to make money, and that money will be used for other things. So, you know, so this is sustainable development. The four C's of sustainable development. First is engaging in context, raising consciousness, assimilating content, and making a contribution. Understanding where you are, enhancing awareness, you know, assimilating the content, and then contributing to the environment. Okay, some building blocks of sustainable development: environment, economy and society, planet, profit and people. Balancing between conserving and protecting the environment and using renewable resources, creating equitable but viable economic systems with an ethical basis, encouraging equitability and responsibility within social and cultural systems and values. And Duplessis has suggested a fourth pillar, which is adaptability, which is continual adjustment according to feedback loops regarding the above. So, now, let me show you a few videos. United Nations has, you know, proposed the development goals, and I would like to show you a series of things here. Now, sustainable development goals here. Let me show you 17 sustainable development. On the 25th of September 2015, countries adopted a set of goals to end poverty, protect the planet, and ensure prosperity for all as part of a new sustainable development agenda. And each goal has specific targets to be achieved over the next 15 years. And these 17 goals are: no poverty, zero hunger, wealth, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice and strong institutions. And the last one is the most important, which is partnerships for these goals. So let's see a video here, you know, that shows us what these goals are all about. Okay, and here is an example of how the sustainable development goals are being implemented in Papua New Guinea. This is a very nice video which explains why and how sustainable development goals tie in with the responsibility of profit-making organizations and how this is making an impact in the developing countries. So with examples of three families from Papua New Guinea, and so let's watch this.
Our journey begins more than 14,000 kilometers from the United Nations in Papua New Guinea as we look at the Sustainable Development Goals, which aim to transform our world by 2030. The 17 goals were adopted at the UN General Assembly by 193 member states in 2015. The objective: produce a set of universal goals that meet urgent social, economic, and environmental challenges facing the world. What makes these goals different? Each goal is dependent on the other goals. These goals are universal, integrated, and transformative. The last goal focuses on the importance of partnership between the government, the UN, development partners, civil society, faith-based organizations, youth groups, communities, and the private sector. Despite the many challenges of life in Papua New Guinea, the government and people of PNG are making great efforts toward the SDGs. Progress will be made only if we work together. We begin with one woman working tirelessly to feed her family. Her name is Susan, and today Susan is in a field tending to her crops as her husband fishes nearby in the ocean. For Susan, her four daughters, and husband, their crops are at risk as the sea level rise affects the salt level in the soil. This means less access to a variety of food and a greater risk of stunting for her daughters. Susan says she's seen a rise in the sea level and also in the sea temperature here. There are fewer fish, she says. There is no reliable transport infrastructure here either, so the family often skips going to health facilities, even though malaria is rampant. Children are often delivered at home without acknowledging the risk.
I'm sick in two to three hours.
Making matters worse, diarrhea is common here, as proper sanitation practices are rare. Susan has only an eighth grade education. Secondary school is not really an option for her family, as there is no secondary school nearby. Another big concern for her: clean water. The encroaching sea is threatening their water supply with salt. For Susan and her family, she says, their big dream is simply surviving, which has become increasingly difficult. Moving to Enga province, we meet Benny Pundi, a subsistence farmer with two wives and six children. Health problems are common here because the nearest hospital is far away. Farmers here rely on rain, so their food production is very unstable. The current rain pattern has changed, and it's unpredictable, making it difficult to plant seeds at exactly the right time. They're limited to a few varieties of crops, so their children are often stunted. These same children must also walk great distances to school and rarely attend beyond early primary. All of the children help work in the fields. There are no close markets to sell their produce, so everything they grow, they eat. They have no source of outside income. Benny's family uses a basic pit latrine and has no electricity or running water. The family relies on firewood cut from the nearby forest. As for the future, Benny wants only two things. And finally, we move to the capital of Port Moresby and the Five Mile Settlement.
My name is Dorothy Robert. My age is 39 and I have six children.
Dorothy runs a small food stand she sets up outside her house each morning.
I made my barbecue, selling drinks, sausages, sometimes selling betel nuts.
They have no garden, so they need to purchase all their food. Dorothy is the only person working, so the family is always suffering from a lack of cash. Her husband has other wives and many other children. He gives her no money. This means her children often skip meals, which leads to stunting. There is also no money to buy school supplies, school uniforms, and lunch. So some of the children don't attend school. In the settlement, everyone uses pit toilets, and washing areas are in poor condition when they exist at all. And the water is cut off frequently. Violence against women is a serious issue here. A 2015 Overseas Development Institute article estimates that 2 in 3 women in Papua New Guinea have experienced gender-based violence in their lifetime. Papua New Guinea has the highest prevalence of gender-based violence in the Western Pacific region. Sadly, Dorothy too has experienced violence in her life.
Domestic violence is very commonly in the settlement.
Dorothy feels trapped by poverty. She has dreams, but worries they won't become reality unless her situation improves.
My dream for my children is I want them to be educated to earn their own living.
These are the stories of real people's lives in Papua New Guinea. The people know that they have rights and are resilient in the face of the adversity they face. Their lives are directly linked to the Sustainable Development Goals. The SDGs are about every single person's life and improving each life in a powerful way. Betterment of a nation starts with the betterment of one person's and one family's life. The SDGs are the milestone for 15 years. 15 years is an accumulation of days. When you live a life, you live a day. So each single day is important if we want a change. Time alone cannot bring us a change. We are the ones who can and must bring that change.
Okay, this is another example of what really is required by the community. You know, I wanted to show you this just to sensitize you as to what is going on. This is not a class on development studies, it's not a class on social welfare, but still, since we are talking about sustainability and sustainable development, it is very, very important for organizations to know what is required out there and how they can support this. Now, the other thing I wanted to show you was, I have shared some links regarding the International Institute for Environment and Development. There is a lecture a brief input by Professor R.B. Singh from Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi, on Sustainable Development Goals and the Indian Experiences. Now, a couple of things that I would like to show you here are how do we communicate these goals, and that is something that is done by the International Program for the Community for the Development of Communication. Let me show you that right here. Okay, so this is the IIED website, International Institute for Environment and Development. Then we have the International Program for the Development of Communication, and this is how these goals are communicated, are shared with people who can help. The other way to doing this is the Communication Initiative Network, which gives us some guidelines, some pointers, some ideas as to how we can go into the community, what is needed by the community, and how we can help. Then some more resources here. The texts, some books that if you want to read up on sustainable development and how you can help are here. Some reading material is here. There is a very nice book called ICT4D, Connecting People for a Better World. So this is available free of cost online. You can download it and read it. The other is Information and Communications Technology for Sustainable Development. It's a report based on two workshops organized by Carnegie Mellon University, Pittsburgh, and the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And they are defining, you know, they defined a global research agenda in the years 2003 and 2004, respectively. So this report is freely available online. Then, you know, so various options are there. Then some examples of how organizations can be committed to doing things for the community, and this is something that I want to show you. You know, one is of course through the CSR programs. The other is to really develop technologies or work along the lines of developing something that will help the community in addition to serving the profit making goals of corporations. And this is something that I really want to show you here. Okay, now this, just a second, let me pull this up. There's a lot that I wanted to show you, but in the interest of time, I cannot. PaveGen is an organization that that makes tiles that generate energy, you know, that transform the kinetic energy generated by people walking over them into electrical energy. So this is very, very interesting here. I'll just show you this very short video. It's a 2-minute 19-second video as to how this is happening, generating energy from footsteps at a busy school.
Hi, my name is Lawrence Campbell Cook. We're here today with PaveGen Systems to install an energy generating floor at Simon Langton Grammar School in Kent in the United Kingdom.
Three of the stated aims of the school are creativity, innovation and altruism. And in terms of what PaveGen have done here, it's certainly creative and it's incredibly innovative. And what more could be altruistic than working towards the future of the planet? Well, you only have to be down here at break time to see huge interest and huge excitement of our students bounce up and down. They read the displays and they're really, really very excited about having this in school.
PaveGen were asked to install an energy-generating walkway into a school with 1,100 pupils. Our technology converts the kinetic energy from a footstep into usable electricity. We're using 50% of the energy generated in a fun, interactive way. The other half of the energy is being stored and used to power some of the lighting within the corridor. An important aspect of the installation is that we monitor the data on site, but also remotely via our data logging equipment. This allows us to understand and process the data from the school on a daily basis.
Oh, well, the PaveGen installation looks superb because it's just a fantastic opportunity for the students to get a visual representation of what they're doing, the way where they can harness energy. It's, you know, it looks good.
Okay, various other options are there. There's one more website that is called sustainablebrands.com, where people are actually making, they're making products that are sustainable. So they're going above and beyond the call of duty. They're not only giving back to society, they're not only making eco-friendly products, they're actually making products that are helping preserve the natural resources. So, you know, innovating in such a way that whatever they make and what, I mean, this is a tile manufacturing company. When we talk about PaveGen, they're making tiles, but they've made tiles that can produce energy. So they've not only made tiles in an eco-friendly, they don't claim to use eco-friendly products, but they are doing something that will replenish the resources that are being used. So, you know, that is the kind of work, or that is the kind of direction that the UN SDGs partners hope that corporations will take. And another example is that of Keto, which is an organization that makes edible cutlery. And so, you know, all of these things are very useful. And they are very helpful in terms of, you know, they provide direction as to how profit-making organizations with all of their resources can really, really help with the sustainable development through their CSR efforts. We will continue our discussion on CSR and sustainability in the next lecture. Thank you very much for listening.